is NMCLI by default installed on RHEL?
Yeah. I mean, how else would you modify your network interfaces? NMCLI is part of Network Manager. It's the tool that's used to tell Network Manager how to configure your devices. Yes.
And so starting with RHEL 7, Network Manager was part of the default package set. So that's what does networking. And even though Network Manager previously had allowed for interface configuration files, the older System 5 way of managing interfaces, it was actually doing some translation layer stuff to get that into Network Manager speak. Network Manager started off as a graphical tool to help people configure their network interfaces. And that's why it uses a database and its architecture is very different. And so I think it was Shantanu asked, like, why did we go to Network Manager? Well, we wanted to make things easier for desktop users. And as part of that, we figured out that there's actually a whole bunch of additional parameters that we can configure outside of what's currently offered in the interface config file method that is really old. And so Network Manager started to be further evolved and was the default in RHEL 7, but you could change it to use a service called Networking, which would turn it back to the IFCFG scripts. RHEL 8, it was the default, and we recommended against using IFCFG scripts. And in RHEL 9, it is the default and only.
Yeah, I remember on 7, it was, I forget what it was. There was something that I couldn't do with it. So I had switched all my 7 boxes back away from Network Manager to networking. And on RHEL 8, whatever that problem was gone. So that's when I started using Network Manager again. And Network Manager always felt like this is meant to solve a desktop problem, because that's where its origins were. It was, imagine your new, let's just say, Fedora laptop, and I want to configure Wi-Fi. Well, Network Manager is a lot easier to configure a Wi-Fi adapter than the old style network scripts were. You could do it, absolutely, but it wasn't as easy. So that's where it came from, and that's why it had that feeling at the beginning. But it's very much not the case anymore. It's definitely a server class Network Manager. Has a lot of features that were tricky with the old style networking.
Nate, can you tell us a little bit about what bonding is?
Sure. Bonding, I mean, if you imagine just the word bonding, it's to take two things and bond them together. Well, in the networking world, bonding means that you take several network interfaces. It doesn't have to be just two. You could have 4 or 8 of them, right? Maybe they have diverse paths back to your data center. Maybe you do it for bandwidth. However, there's lots of ways that you could do it, but it takes them and bonds them into a single virtual interface, which then shares the redundancy and shares the network throughput, right? So in the days when you were running like only gigabit or only, I say only gigabit now, like gigabit is slow, but when you had only gigabit and you were like connecting to your storage array and you needed more throughput, you'd bond interfaces to get to that storage array so it'd be faster. Just one example.
And there are different modes of running bonded interfaces. So what Nate was just describing is called aggregation, link aggregation, where you're like tying them together into a single interface so you can use bandwidth on both interfaces for traffic, which then gets you more bandwidth in and out of your machine. In my example, I'm going to set up a failover configuration. So I have set up, and if one dies, the other one just takes over their shared IP address and start serving it again. So it allows you to have some high availability for your networking, such that if your switch dies and that kills your link, your other interface will start taking over that traffic and dealing with it out of a different switch. So there's a whole bunch of different configurations of bonding, but yeah, it's like taking two interfaces, sticking them together to use them as a single device for the system. All right. So in the olden times, you would have to have multiple configuration files to describe which interfaces belonged to your bonded interface and then what all the settings were on your bonded interface. But Network Manager actually makes that a lot easier. And you can set this all up through NMCLI through a series of commands, similar to what Nate was doing earlier with setting our manual IP address and setting our DNS settings. We can do that with setting up bonded interfaces too. However, Red Hat Enterprise Linux comes with a technology called RHEL system roles. RHEL system roles are based on Ansible. So RHEL comes with the set of system roles as well as Ansible core to help you use the functionality in the system roles. And you basically just write an Ansible playbook. And I've written one here. I used the very inventive name bond playbook, but basically you set up the hosts that you want to apply this change to. So if you had like a whole bunch of hosts that were identical and you wanted to set up the same thing across all of them, you could specify a list of hosts to go out and execute this change across all these different machines automatedly. I'm just going to make this change to localhost.
Yeah, obviously you wouldn't make that IP address the same on all the hosts, so keep that in mind.
Yeah. You may need to like wrap something like this with a little bit more logic to make better decisions, but here we go. So I'm applying this only to localhost, and I'm going to define a new connection called bond zero, and it's going to be turned on, and its type is a bond, right? As opposed to Ethernet or wireless or some of the other types that are available through Network Manager. I'm going to assign an IP address. So here's the IP address I want it to have. I'm going to assign it some DNS settings, right? Which Nate showed us how to manually change, but we're just going to include it in our configuration here. And some DNS search domains. All right, then I said that bonds have things like different methods of interacting, right? So here, this mode, I'm setting up my bond to be an active backup, right? So one of the network interfaces is going to be responsible for all the traffic, unless it dies, in which case it'll all move over to the other network interface. So one of them will be active, one of them will be the backup. And then MIMON, so the way it's going to determine whether an interface dies or is healthy is by checking its link status. And so this MII monitor is how frequently we should check that link status. And so if you needed it to recognize that the link is down earlier, you could make that number smaller. If you occasionally have weirdnesses in your network, so that if it immediately went down, you might want to hang on for a minute before you shift over to the other interface, you can make it larger. So that's the timeout that is going to occur. All right, and then down towards the bottom, what network interfaces make up my bond? The first one I'm going to call member one, and it's an Ethernet interface. Here's the interface name, right? This is what it lives in Network Manager as, its device name, and it's going to be controlled by bond zero. Number two, also an Ethernet, it's got a different device name, and it's also going to roll up into bond zero. All right, and at the very end, it says I need to load the RHEL system role called network. So that's who's going to parse this list of variables and make these assignments. Now, what's really cool about system roles is they're written and maintained by Red Hat engineers. So they make very good Red Hat decisions, like it knows that Network Manager manages devices. And so even though these devices are going to be members of this new bond, they may have previously been standalone interfaces with their own IP addresses. And so it will actually make changes to them, convert them to be membership of this bond, and deconfigure some of the individual things they may have had going on their interfaces. All right, so let's do a Ansible playbook, bond playbook. So it's going through and like checking the status of different things and what are the flags and are we running Network Manager? Do we have the right software? And then, I get an error message.
This is why we test these things in prod, Scott.
Right. I tested it last night on a different machine, but I had to manually recreate the configuration file. Let's see. Invalid key DNS. Okay, so we'll do this just for the sake of getting us back on track. Nope, still no. DNS search. So maybe I have the wrong stuff in there. We'll just do IP address. The other kind of cool thing about system roles is that later on when I'm ready to like troubleshoot my DNS settings, I can just add them in to the playbook again. And because the playbook has the same content as before, when it gets to things like configuring the bond interface, that's already done. So it would skip over that part. And then when it gets to the new things, like my corrected DNS settings, I would go ahead and apply those changes. All right, so this looks much better. And if I IPA, there's my new bonded network interface with the address that I assigned to it. And you could see, I mentioned earlier that it would deconfigure the others, right? So these guys before had their own IP addresses, but we can see that they've been stripped away and now they're just using these interfaces to service that shared IP address that they both have. All right, so that was pretty quick and easy to set up a bonded interface, and it does all the right Red Hat things and all the right network configuration things, thanks to the RHEL system rules. And if you have the wrong stuff in there, notice it produced an error that you could troubleshoot and diagnose, and then just re-execute the system rule once you've got it fixed and everything will be fine.
And those features that Scott had to take out do work. Probably a typo or something, or a invalid placement of where they were.
Like maybe they were not intended enough, or they were intended too much. But as we're getting past time, I don't want to spend a bunch of time troubleshooting it. Maybe another
you want to live troubleshoot too? Come on.
Yeah.
Troubleshooting your Ansible playbooks on into the terminal.
Exactly. What could possibly
be wrong? That sounds like a frustrating episode.